going to do a lesson in English and then tell you a little bit about each room, and then please feel free to look around and ask questions. But the most important thing to know is that this is the house that Anina and Edvard Grieg had built for themselves. So they bought this beautiful plot of land from the farmer because it wasn't practical for him to have animals here. You see, there's a steep slope right down to the water. So they didn't pay too much, it was quite reasonable. And then Grieg's cousin was just educated as an architect. So they had a family member who could help them draw up the design for their dream house, you might say. So there were a lot of choices that were very deliberate, and they reflect the personality of Nina and Edvard Grieg. They wanted a house that was airy and bright. So they chose high ceilings and lots of large windows. Houses that might be used all year round. Obviously, you'd have low ceilings, you'd have tiny windows to keep the heat in. But they wanted this kind of big, airy villa style, and they had travelled an enormous amount throughout Europe. So they'd been inspired, obviously, by the way houses could look, especially down south. So this house was a summer house. They had a few winters here, but it was too cold. And they wanted the beautiful Norwegian pine. So all of the ceilings, floors, everything was Norwegian pine and mainly untreated. So as you go through the house, all of the walls and the ceilings in the two main rooms, it's all the original wood. The floor has been swapped. And in the next two rooms, all of the furniture is original. So it's a really special atmosphere, and you can see it how it was when they actually lived here. And the house was completed in 1885. Before then, at this time, Grieg was 42 and Nina was 40 years of age. So they were in their middle age, but they'd never really had a proper home before. They hadn't really had a house where they felt kind of stable and always came back. They were always travelling, giving concerts, living in the big cities, visiting friends. Grieg's hometown was Bergen, and he came back and visited his family again and again. But both of his parents died in 1875. And then he felt that he'd lost some of his roots to his hometown. So that's one of the reasons why they chose to build a house here, with a train line, just 15 minutes walk, a train that took them into the centre, or even all the way to Voss. That was built 2 years before this house. And obviously the nature here is wonderful, very, very inspiring for Grieg, and the west of Norway is really where his heart lay. This is the nature that inspired a lot of his compositions. And upstairs they had a bedroom and a guest room, because they loved to have guests. When they travelled around Europe and made friends with all these great composers and musicians, they invited everybody to come here, because Grieg said, if you come here, if you breathe the air and you see the nature, you will be inspired to write your next composition. He was completely convinced everybody would be inspired. And he had a little study living room, and he tried in the beginning to use this as a place to compose. But he was a very sensitive artist, very sensitive to any small sounds. So he lost his focus very easily. And he knew this about himself because they deliberately didn't have electricity or running water in the house. So they had a little utus, and when you take the path down to the grave, you'll see the well. But even so, it still wasn't the perfect place. So 7 years after this house was built, he had a little composing hut built by the water, and this was a place just for Grieg to have complete silence and focus and compose music when he was here. So a lot of the days had the same rhythm. Grieg would be in his house, Nina would be here. She had the company of her sister, who lived here for a lot of the time they were here. Grieg called her his second wife, and they also had two maids. So this was actually the kitchen when they lived here, and this was a little room for the two maids who helped Nina with everything to do with the house, often cooking. Because she was a singer, she was an artist, she performed, she travelled with Grieg, gave concerts with him. She was equally well known at that time. She hadn't been taught how to cook food and run a household, so she needed a little bit of help. So as I said, this was the kitchen. Now we call it the memory room. So you see sketches of Grieg, all these beautiful depictions of him, but it wasn't him that necessarily wanted to be depicted. I think the artists would approach him and ask, could I draw you? Because he himself had a kind of difficult relationship with his kind of person. He was very conscious of him being very petite, and also when he was 16, he was very ill, and his left lung was actually collapsed. So he lived the rest of his life with one lung and slightly sunken. So he often stood like this, and he preferred to be depicted with his arms folded, or with an extra jacket, or even sat down. So I think this was the choice of the artist. Please, Edvard Grieg, can I draw you? Can I make a bust of you? This is a very famous bust of Grieg, and when he saw it, he said, it's not bad, it's not good, it's all right. He wasn't going to impress anybody with his comments. He was like, yeah, it's fine. It wasn't something that he wanted. He didn't like this fame game. He just wanted to compose and travel and meet people and live that kind of lifestyle. You see, there's a photograph here. This is early in the morning on Grieg's 60th birthday. And you see he took one step closer to the camera and had his typical Grieg pose. Mm-hmm. And on the left-hand side, you see the great Norwegian writer, Bjørnstjerne Bjørnson. So he knew many great writers and musicians and artists in Norway. There was a lot of collaboration in Norway at that time. It's known kind of as the golden age of Norwegian history. And this day, there was a big party in the garden, because his birthday is on the 15th of June, so I think it tended to be good weather. And you can see a photograph of his the garden party for his 60th birthday. So we like to keep this tradition alive, and we celebrate his birthday with coffee and cake. And this was the one big celebration. They also had a big celebration for Edvard Grieg's, him and his wife's 25th wedding anniversary. So if you hear the piece of music, Wedding Day at Trollhogen, that is a piece that he rewrote in memory of the big party and celebration they had here. And these two big parties came with lots of guests and lots of beautiful objects. So as we go through the house, all of the beautiful objects that catch your eye, these were gifts to him and his wife. They themselves had quite simple taste, but they had very generous friends, we could say. And please feel free to have a look after we've been through the house. All the details, please ask questions. And before we go into the dining room, you see Edvard Grieg. This is when he was 25. And obviously many composers live their whole life without feeling any sense of fame or the way their music is received, getting an idea of this. But when he was 25, he composed his piano concerto in A minor, and this really was a breakthrough and kind of put him on the map in Europe. So it was performed more and more in the great European cities, and people suddenly knew his name. He was a young man when he had his breakthrough. Yeah. Would you like to come and see the dining room and living room?
Nee, zijn neef die was architect. Die was getekend. Nee.